We are very glad to have you join us this afternoon for this briefing on what environmental action is China taking after ERS. Obviously, there are uncertainty, many questions post the election. The important thing, I think, for all of us to know is that there are, at the same time, many issues that we are continuing to face that are ongoing, and through which there are so many people, societies, countries engaged around the world. And certainly in terms of addressing climate and the many facets of that issue are under consideration by governments, by cities, in virtually every country of our planet. And we are just even today hearing information coming back from Marrakesh, where there are climate meetings that are continuing that will be finalizing their work at the end of this week. And therefore, it is, I think, particularly appropriate that we have a distinguished panel of us here today to talk about issues that are important to countries that are working together, particularly in terms of China, which, like the United States, is a very large greenhouse gas emitter, a large energy consumer, and obviously a very large economy. And therefore, we all have much to learn from each other, and that is an opportunity that we have through engaging in discussions and dialogue with colleagues from other countries, both at their national level and at provincial levels and at local government levels. And we are so pleased to be holding this briefing today in conjunction with the International Fund for China's Environment. And at this time, I would like to ask the president of the International Fund for China's Environment, IFCE, Peng He, to come forward and also make a few remarks.
Thank you, Carol. We are pleased to co-host this briefing of this Environmental Energy Study Institute. International Fund for China Environment is a non-profit group in Washington, D.C. We've been actually for long, quite a long time, this EESI, exactly 20 years of anniversary. So our main mission is to promote U.S. and China environmental and climate changes and collaboration. Since Copenhagen Climate Summit, we noticed the biggest obstacle of international climate agreement already rely on the U.S.-China collaborations. So after that, in 2010, we launched a U.S.-China Climate Roundtable. The first one was with the UN Foundation. Since then, we have been every year hold a Climate Roundtable, bringing experts from both sides, thinking tank experts and research scientists, to talk and discuss and dialogue before they head into the negotiating table. So we should help eventually last year's Paris Climate Agreement. Last year, we expanded our dialogue roundtable to a low carbon city tour. So we invite experts from the US from here and also state officials from different states, Michigan, Arizona, to travel to China and tour different cities, Shanghai, Beijing, Chengdu, Changsha, and they witness and different activities, events about low carbon development. So they are very impressed. So this year we invite people from China, experts from China, mostly from local level, because at the Chinese Academy of Science, to the U.S. and to learn what's going on in the U.S. and then also they can use their activities to ask the counterparts in different cities. So Monday they visited Boston, and yesterday they had a roundtable with the State Department about climate resilience. And today we have a briefing here with Capitol Hill. And tomorrow they're heading to the Detroit, also the Toronto, Canada. So we hope this kind of dialogue and tour. Both sides can exchange what's going on in the local activities. The most important climate mitigation and adaptation is rely on local activities. We have a new government and with some changes, but the local activities will be important. So we hope through this kind of dialogue and discussion presentation, both sides can learn more each other on the activities, plans, challenges, then build more confidence on both sides. So we can build this together and move forward for the low carbon and green development world. So with that, I look forward to the presentation. Hope this briefing be informative and useful to all of you. And we look forward to this, the talk and the presentation and the follow-up discussions. Thank you.
Thank you so much for outlining the whole efforts of this group, which is here learning about what is happening here in the U.S. as well as Americans learning in all of these different cities where this delegation is going, learning about the challenges, the problems, and how they are being addressed on the mitigation and adaptation side. Which is all a very, very exciting dialogue, and we are delighted to be part of that. So we are hearing today from a panel of environmental professionals that is going to discuss some of the challenges and the progress that are associated with setting emission reduction policies, how to implement national climate targets at the local level, as well as how to provide incentives for supply chain sustainability, and many more related issues. So our first speaker of our panel of three, and I want to say welcome to you all. We are delighted that you are here with us. And I should also say at the outset that if you have follow-up questions coming out of the briefing today, please let us know, and we are happy to work with our partners to try and make sure that we all are able to get those questions answered so that indeed we can pursue this dialogue so that we all can learn more and help each other through these processes of trying to improve the situation at local levels in our countries and around the world. So we will first hear from Jiansheng Qu and Dr. Tu, and I am sorry for mispronouncing your name, please forgive me, serves as the director of the Chinese Academy of Sciences Scientific Information Center for Resources and Environment in Longzhou. This research body advises national level leadership on science and policy options relating to climate change. His work explores the effects of climate change on populations at a regional scale, the role of urbanization in carbon reduction, and as we know, urbanization is increasing around the world. And he is also doing work through the Clean Development Mechanism.
This week, and the UNFCCC Climate Change Conference is holding in Moscow. And we know all the people research on climate change, we know there are no any surprise on this conference, because the biggest surprise is given by the two presidents of the US and China last year. And we begin a new climate change period after Kyoto Protocol, we signed the Paris Agreement. Yeah, my presentation will introduce some information of China. What China is doing in after Paris Agreement. And before this, I will show some slides on the background of carbon emission. And we know the climate change is from the carbon from 1750s. 1750, yes. And who contributed for the carbon emission? We know. Yeah, because we are from the fossil fuel. And also the big country, the industry. And before 2006, US is the biggest emitter. And after the, that year, China can take the position. We are the two important countries of the climate change. And, but a little different between our two countries. Because we know US is the GDP of US is more than China's. But why the carbon emission, China is take the first position? It's the industry structure, the energy structure is very different also. And we also will find some other difference between the economy, the life level also is different. In China, the income for the people is lower, and also is very different between the urban regions and the rural regions. Yeah, from this figure, we will find this information. Also, there are still more than 55 people is under the poor level, and the standard of World Bank. So many people. Then in China, we should also the core task of the China government is like so many people are on the board. And we will find the information from the EESI. And we developed our economies, but left the pollution is left in China. Yeah, we will find the PM2.5. We know it's a very big problem, environmental problem in China, in North China. But when we discuss the economics, we know we want to change our life, the people's life, human life. And it's different. In the developed country and developing country, we will find what the emission, carbon emission is emitted for the people. My research group have such a research on household carbon emission. It's a very interesting research. We will find the many developed countries have very high house carbon emission. Yeah. And but in China and some other developing countries is lower. This is from the many scientists in over the world. Also, our research in the group have a research assets and our comparison. Here in China, per capita household carbon emission is very low, not two. But in Canada and UK, it's very high, it's per capita. But when we discuss this, I don't mean China will have a high emission and the developed country. It's different because, yes, in the past 200 years, the developed country have emitted so much, but now the style is changed. China and also the other developing country will enjoy the high level technology. We will have a different possible. Also, my research group have a survey research in China for the life carbon emission. We get about 16,000 families in China, and include 31 families. With our research found, the average level for one people in China carbon emission is 2.6 ton CO2 per capita. And the lowest is in Anhui province in the here. in Anhui province is very low, just 1.3. The highest region is Beijing City. It's just 2.6. Not too high. I just said, in China, maybe we will the household carbon emission will rise, but maybe the peak will come soon. We will find the difference between the east region and the west region in China. Be similar with the west country and the east country, developed country and developed country. Very similar. Yeah, we will find that in China, the urban region, the carbon emission, household carbon emission, is higher than the rural region. And also a little different, very interesting. And most now in China, the carbon emission for life generally is from the basic demands of the life. For example, the high education and the traffic travel or visiting some other place, the high level carbon emission is very low. Yes, maybe next time, if the China people, their lifestyle continue developing, and maybe we will have change the data. Yes, it will increase, but I think not more than the developing country. Another information from the house conditions. Yeah, in China, the house condition is improved very fast. From this figure, we will find, and the housing area is increased very fast. Yeah, but now maybe after 5 or 10 years, it will arrive with the peak. Yeah, it's maybe not a big problem. And also, in China, the infrastructure is increased very fast also. The road, the railway, the waterway, also the flight is increased very fast. And when we will arrive at the peak? I think maybe, we can discuss this, maybe not more than 10 years. And because the China government has set the target, we will arrive at the carbon emission peak before 2030. This picture showed the very difference in China in China and the eastern, the west, the central, and the whole country. And what's the emission is different. And also the intensity and the impact, we have a comparison. We will find it's very different in China. In the east, generally, it's similar with the developed country. In the west, and we have a high emission intensity, but the impact is low. Yeah, it's similar with the developed country. How to deal with the problem in China? From the 20 years before, 1996, we began to set so many climate change targets and a working plan. And we have a five-year plan. Every 5 years, we will make a national plan. From 1996, we do this on the climate change. And so many jobs. And also we get very good achievements. For example, in the 11th 5 year plan, we arrive at the target. The target is in next 5 years. And we will reduce the carbon emission per day to 20% of the level of 2005. Finally, we achieve it. And in the 12th 5 year plan, also we get the target. And now this year is the opening year of the third 5 year plan. And this year, the central government, the local government, and many departments have completed their five-year plan. So many, I select several important. And there, we different plan according to their target and meet their main task. And so many. And generally, it's focused on the three aspects. One is carbon emission reduction. One is adaptation resilience to climate change. It's capacity. And also, we want to have very tightly cooperation with the world. Okay. And the main target of the national plan in the next 5 years, we will look. Yes, the first task target is to reduce carbon intensity per GDP and to increase the new energy and also build carbon electricity and to accelerate to realize the carbon peak before 2030. And we set the target and divide it into different aspects. For example, what is the reduction target before 2020? And we will reduce the carbon emission per GDP to 40 to 45% of the level of 2005. And also to reduce the carbon intensity to 60 to 65% of the level of 2005. Yeah. Okay, yes. Also the new energy, yes, is a very good job in China. But we still want to do this very good in the coming 5 years and to increase the ratio of new energy to 15% by 2020. And by 2030, and we will arrive at 20%. Also, we have some other target to realize the action plan. From last year, the central government began to build China Trading City. Yes, from this year, earlier of this year, all the job is very fast, is going very fast. And next year, 2017, we will achieve to open the carbon trading city. And before 2020, and we will realize the target. That means going well. Yeah. Okay. According to this target, we have also built the detailed working plan actions and divide the task to different departments and want to realize this target before 2020. This slide showed the detailed indicator of the five-year plan. We will find there include energy structure, also the carbon emission per GDP, and also the new energy proportion, and here is some other pollution targets. This is the reduction target. Also, China government pay more attention on adaptation. It's very important for so big a country. And in different cities, different provinces. And the local government set their adaptation target according to their conditions. For example, in the central cities, they discuss their working plan on the sea level rise. And in the angry region, they discuss some other things. In the different cities, they set their adaptation effort tasks. For example, in some city, they have more rainfall. They will set due to the sponge city sea level. Yeah, it's very important in China because the city now is bigger and become bigger and bigger. When the rainfall coming, and it's very big problem. But now the government knows this. They are building the sponge city. Also, this slide shows what we will do on the international cooperation in the coming 5 years. We want to get more high technology from the developed country. We know it's very difficult because, yes, it's all the high technology is from the company. In China, also, we share our technology to the other developing countries. And we will do, I think, in the new period of climate change, we can do much on the cooperation over the world. Yes, and in China, we are doing the low carbon dialogues from 2007. We have built two phases in China. Now, the third phase is designed by the NRDC. And maybe in this month or next month, we will release the new phase of the low carbon dialogue. Yeah, we will do many things, so many things on the low carbon society building. Also, so many cities, they build their local government target of how to address the climate change problems. We are building the new city from the central government to local government. We are building so many targets according to different aspects of the society. Also, this slide is the China carbon trading system, we will do. And the final target is before 2020. And such a system will be doing well in China. That means so many countries will attend in this system. It will, the system will become the biggest carbon trading system in the world. Before this is the European carbon system. And the final part of my presentation is the carbon emission peak of China. In the 5-year plan of China, we discussed before 2030, we will get the carbon emission peak. It's very hard job, I think. It's easy according to the new technology, new system, new policy. And now, more than 20 provinces and cities set their peak target by themselves. For example, Ningbo is a city in the east. It will arrive at the peak in 2018. Many cities of China. Many cities maybe set their target in this year. Then if we, this is the cities and provinces have released their target of the peak. And maybe, I think in the end of this year, maybe more cities will release their target. And the final target is national carbon emissions reach to peak for 2030. Some provinces and cities achieve the peak in advance. Yes. It's my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tu. That was a wonderful, comprehensive overview of the steps that your country is taking and the targets that have been laid out, and also the challenges that you are also facing with increased urbanization and what that means for dealing with emissions and making sure that there is housing and how to best address all of those issues. So we will now turn to Lingling Mu, who is the Secretary General of the Tianjin Green Supply Chain Association. She holds a Master of Common Law from the University of Hong Kong, where she successfully organized the very first batch of voluntary carbon and energy efficiency trading in China. We've already heard a little bit about the trading issue. She has also participated in a series of large-scale infrastructure projects, and this year she also undertook the Ministry of Housing and Urban Rural Development's research project on the Green Supply Chain Index for the construction industry in China. So this is a very exciting proposition, and I look forward to hearing much more. Thank you.
Madam Chair, with thought and honor, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is my great honor to be here to have this discussion. My presentation will be outlined in three parts. Firstly, China's green actions create a market bond. Secondly, market mechanism is an important measure for China to realize green transformation. Thirdly, Tianjin practice on green development. As you may know, the launching of milestone developments of the Paris Agreement, 2013 UN Agenda, Montreal Protocol, and the Group 20, as well as the APEC leaders' declaration, marked a brand new era of climate and environment tackling that is more matured and constructive. China actively participated in the negotiation and signing of these international agreements. The new leadership highlighted green development as one of the most important as one of the five major development guidelines of China for the next decade, and introduced a series of important national national program accordingly in respect of environmental pollution control. Ten rules are introduced respectively for the pollution control of the air, water, and soil since last year. Meanwhile, in respect of combating climate change, China's intended nationally determined contribution to combat climate change is set for that. The remarkable achievement made is that quantifiable, measurable, and verifiable targets are set forth in this kind of plan. Therefore, trillions and trillions of green demand are so created. For example, the EINDC alone will call for investment amount of 30 trillion RMB from 2016 to 2030. Climate change is extremely sophisticated, and the traditional administrative measures are far from sufficient. China actively introduced market mechanisms in this regard, which mainly includes to promote the establishment of cap and trade carbon market, hopefully the national-wide integrated market will be launched by the end of next year with an estimated market value of 1.2 billion to 8 billion yuan. China also actively implemented the green procurement for green level products and started green supply chain management demonstration program at city level since 2011. The 13th five-year frame of the nation published this March, which is the most important document for city for national development, brought forward green supply chain management establishment for the first time. Related national departments also issued a series of regulations to support. China vigorously promotes green finance recently, which definitely will inject dramatic impetus for sustainable development. China witnessed a blowout in its green bond issuing scale since last year. In 2015, issuing scale of green bonds in China is $8.9 billion. Accounting for 3.6 of the world's total issuance scale. Well, in this year, to the present, the issuance scale reached 134 billion, accounting for 45% of the world's total issuance scale. The Chinese regulatory officials are conducting research on greening the investment, and our center was invited to participate in this research program. At the same time, related government departments of China are also actively conducting research on carbon tax in order to provide concrete basis for carbon pricing. Now, I would like to briefly give you a brief on Tianjin practice on green development. Tianjin is located 1 kilometer to the southern of Beijing city with an area of 12,000 square kilometers and a population of 15 million. And Tianjin is an advanced modern manufacturing base and financial innovation center of China. Tianjin port is the fourth largest port in the world and the most critical channel in the Northern Asia. Tianjin is also one of the earliest opening up city in China. As the third engine of economic growth in China after Shenzhen and Shanghai Pudong, Tianjin's GDP growth rate has ranked the top for several years recently. And the environmental and climate challenges are critical. According to the national 13th five-year work plan for controlling green gas emissions, Tianjin needs to reduce carbon emission intensity of 20.5, which is very challenging. Tianjin takes the lead in introducing market mechanism to address the challenge of climate change by establishing the first climate exchange in China and introduced Chicago Climate Exchange and is one of the seven carbon-free demonstrating fusion cities. Tianjin leads China's government procurement, saved energy of 50 million kilowatts and reduced CO2 emissions of 170,000 metric tons by 2012. And in the year of 2015, environmental products totaled 136 billion yuan. Tianjin is the first city to start green supply chain management and has developed a city-level pilot in steel construction materials, a low-carbon city construction, government green procurement and market services system establishment. The 22nd APEC Economic Leaders Declaration in 2014 endorsed the establishment of APEC Cooperation Network on Green Supply Chain. And Tianjin Pilot Center. The center was launched in June 2015. JCAP and KT has joined the network by now, which are two leading environmental research institutes in Australia and Korea. An English website of the network was launched and welcomed by APEC and hopefully to be able to link with official website of APEC by the end of this year. To enhance information, connectivity, transparency, traceability among Asia Pacific region, a series of rules, guidelines and standards have been issued, which are the first bunch of this kind in China. A green procurement tool was launched this September in association with the sustainability consultant who developed hundreds of tools for Walmart. Tianjin Center launched the first online green bidding system recently together with a leading state-owned bidding platform. The design and construction of an excellent peace center is undergoing. In terms of green finance, Tianjin Center developed a green credit evaluation model in construction industry and successfully built a green credit evaluation system of energy management contract, which was embraced by some commercial institutes. Tianjin released the first green supply chain index of domestic listed companies all of them are real property development companies, together with China National Standard Institute. In sum, China's vision of environment emission reduction and combating climate change is urgent, a huge potential market. The introduction of various marketing measures offers unlimited possibility to attracting international cooperation on technology and capital. Yesterday, the meeting of Minister of APEC was issued, which vigorously comments the progress of the network. As two of the most important members of APEC, the United States and China may take leadership jointly on the development of the network. I therefore propose cooperation suggestions as set forth below. Firstly, to promote green finance, including offshore green bond, green investment fund, and offshore carbon market integration. Secondly, to facilitate connectivity of green and low carbon data by website linkage and information sharing. Thirdly, to encourage industrial associations and cities in the US to join APEC Green Supply Chain Network. Fourthly, welcome dialogue, workshop, and visits of various types like today's event. Fifthly, to co-construct green procurement cross-border platform, facilitate advanced low-carbon and eco-protection technologies in the U.S. to enter Chinese market and also mutually. We have an old saying in Chinese that when everybody adds for the flames rise high, under the same sky and border the same ocean, we are called to work together, hand in hand, to tackle the change. Thank you very much.
And once again, kind of expectations that we can achieve by working together. And these are most interesting models, and I applaud your work. Our third speaker this afternoon is Xinyue Liu, who is the senior engineer at the Sichuan Environmental Engineering Appraisal Center, where she is dedicated to negotiating, implementing, and managing regional and foreign environmental projects. Before working at the Environmental Engineering Center, she worked as a consultant at UNEP, the United Nations Environmental Program, where she worked on ecological disaster risk reduction projects in Afghanistan, Sudan, South Sudan, India, and Syria. All areas of unbelievable challenges. So, welcome.
Hi everyone. I'm very pleased to stand here to tell you the story this afternoon. So my topic is how does the local government respond to the current policy? My story will be structured into these four parts. Reasons to respond to climate policy and push forward the air pollution control policy. Relations between climate policy and air pollution control policy. How does Chinese governmental system respond to the policy, as well as policy related to low carbon development from the environmental departments? Because as you know, in China it's a little bit different. The environmental departments are mainly take the work of pollution control and treatment. But for the emission reduction, greenhouse gas emission, the issues like this will be the major work for the Development and Reform Commission. So my view will be from the environmental point of view. So when we talk about the reasons, I think I identify the stress. So it's external stress and internal stress. External stress, that's the international role our country, China, is playing in the world. As you know, no matter from the Kyoto Protocol or the Paris Climate Treaty, we have this temperature control, and we also mentioned about adaptation, resilience, and also promote financial mechanism to make sure the treaty can be properly implemented. So China, as you know, we have taken like 20% of the world greenhouse gas emission. So this is a huge percentage. So we feel we have the responsibility and the obligation to take actions in the world. So when we talk about the internal stress, as you know, in the past decades, our development mode is very expensive. That is why we consume most of our resources, and now we are facing the resources shortage, and we are facing severe environmental pollution, the degradation of ecosystem. And now we realize all of these have become an obstacle to fill our Chinese dream. So what's our Chinese dream? I think from the person, just like everyone, you sitting here, we want the blue sky, we want to see food. And from the macro perspective, I think we are the big country in the world. We feel we have the obligation to be to take the positive lead to contribute to the world harmony and sustainable development. So this is the features in the past, the 5 to 8 years. And you can see the smog phenomenon in China, very serious. The first picture, you can see the middle-aged woman. She is wearing a mask and is still doing the exercise, the body exercise in the morning. And you can see the kids, they wear the mask, walk in the street and go to school. And also you can see the disappearing buildings in the cities. And that's a picture when winter comes and it's still like 4 o'clock in the afternoon that you can not see the sky well. And before I came here, my baby, my kid, is just like 2.5 years old, and he also gets his respiratory problems and very frustrating. So the Chinese people now, we are realizing we should deal these issues. And this picture I did from NASA, and you can see here is China. I think it's when we get the darkest red in the world. And here this region is Huabei Plateau and the eastern part of China. And here, the dot here is where I come from, it's Sichuan province. It's a plain area. That is why when the winter comes and all the pollutants are accumulated up in the air and it cannot get out. And here I would like to share a case study done by Peking University in 5 cities in China. With these five cities are very with very strong representative in China. Here is one. This one is Beijing, as you know, the capital city, and Shanghai, and Guangzhou, and Chengdu, where I'm from, and Wuhan, Shenyang. So these 5 cities, they are respectively in 5 important economic roles. And they take up over 50% GDP of our country, and we have huge energy consumption. And all these cities are severely affected by air pollution and smog. And so the research based on these 5 cities can provide pragmatic evidence to pollution prevention and training. So you can see the diagrams from here, from the racial pollution status, racial severe pollution, racial good air quality, and average hours of consecutive pollution. And you can see my city, Chengdu, actually is the worst. It's not Beijing. So we always say, okay, we should have more attention from the central government than is what the local people is always like, asking for. And this is the pictures, the charts. They show the air pollution status in 4 seasons. Beijing has very minimum variation in seasons. So like in every season, it's all more or less the same. But here in Chengdu, you can see in winter, it's really very serious, as I explained, because it's a plain and the pollutants can not go out. So now we focus a lot on carbon emission control, as we are talking about today. And when we talk about emission reduction, we also feel like for the Chinese people, air pollution control is maybe more important than emission reduction. But it seems these two issues are a little bit contradictory, because when you want to improve, when you want to do the air pollutants treatment, you have to consume energies. So we have to deal with these two issues together. That is what we are thinking about, the coordinates of control. And here, I drew a picture about the energy structure of China, and you can see still heavily relying on coal as our main energy resource. So, but I think in U.S., the major energy source is nuclear power, right? So I think we still have a huge gap, a huge space to make improvements. Then, how can we achieve the goal? So now here we have the national policy, and once we have the national policies, and our political parties will respond to the policies. And when we have a new policy, it indicates we have a market there. And also as a public, we will know, okay, what's the focus, what's the most attention of the government is trying to do. So we will help the government, will help the public understand the current policies through certain education. So here I list some laws and regulations issued in recent years, but they are just a very few. You can see especially the action plan of air pollution prevention and treatment, law of air pollution prevention and treatment, also the low carbon economy in national agro-industrial, and also the work plan for greenhouse gas emission control in the surgeon's 5-year plan. And we still have more than this. So once we have a policy at the national level, how can we implement? This is the action plan for the air pollution prevention and control issued by the State Council on September 2013. And you can see here we have 10 actions. The highlighted ones are related to emission reduction, like comprehensive control and reduce emission, industrial optimize industrial structure, promote industrial restructure and technology transformation, improve the innovation capacity, also like increase clean energy supply. But all of these are very like at a macro scope, macro level. But how can we implement? So I will take my province as the example, like Sichuan province. So once we have the national level action plan, and our provincial government will make the response, will respond to the national plan. So we will have the provincial action plan. And then once we have a provincial action plan, the cities in the province will take the further response. So we will have the city level action plan. And in each city, we have made several districts. So the district will respond to the action plan as well. So we will have district action plans. So like this one, this is the provincial action plan for the air pollution prevention and control in Sichuan. And you can see this one becomes like more detailed. It will say, okay, we will fix out the capacity, we will do the general control of coal consumption, upgrade and move out the heavy food industry, we will do the self-fertilization, the electrification, that's the move. And we also will renovate coal, find owner, we will do these things. So it will be like more in detail. And then when it comes to the municipal level action plans, we will list specific projects, such as, okay, in the city, we have these plants. So we'll say, okay, in these years, and these plants must do this kind of improvements, meet these certain standards. So you should do this, after that, there will be more in detail. It will highlight the guiding unit, responsible unit, and participating unit. So you will know who's doing what. And then the second piece that I would like to share with you about the low-carbon economy in National Eco-Industrial Park. This is issued by the General Office of Ministry of Environmental Protection. The purpose of this is to urge the National Eco-Industrial Park to incorporate the theory of circular economy, low-carbon economy, and the eco-industry. Take low energy consumption, low emission, less pollution as foundation to improve energy use efficiency and energy structure through industrial optimization, technology innovation, and operating management. And I don't know how many of you have been to Irving Mountain. This is a really famous site in Sichuan. It's also the World Cultural and Natural Heritage site, and you can see the view. But I have to tell you, this beautiful site is only 5 to 6 kilometers away from the urban city. But this city is an industrial city, and its major economy depends on, as you can see, the chemical and building materials. So it really has already had a pollution. So that is why the city realized, okay, it's very important for us to develop the eco-industry. That is why they do this eco-industrial park. As you can see, what the improvements they are making. And then they will, once they reach the municipal standard eco-industrial park, and they will try their efforts to move to the provincial standards and then to the national standards. So they're still on their way. And this is really new, the ecological line, red line, what we are doing. So what is ecological red line? So it's a line drawn up based on or referring to the areas of major ecofunction, environmental sensitivity, and fragility. And it's a bottom line for national and regional eco-security, playing an important role in maintaining eco-security, guaranteeing eco-service function, and supporting economic and social sustainability. So the eco, so the red line will help us clarify the maximum consumption of resources to strengthen the coordination of and control of total consumption of resources and the management of consumption intensity. So also the red line, we have the national red line. But like the case in Sichuan is we have the provincial red line, but they include the same line. And then when we go down, we have the municipal level red line and the county level red line. So this is a map of Sichuan, and the bottom of the left is red. And so you can see Osprey. So all the red are waiting lines, which means we cannot develop anymore. So they are protected. And I have put several slides. If the time is limited, then we can leave it for question. So this is my city, Chengdu, the capital city of Sichuan. This is another city. And this is our architectural region. So what the red line protect? So they protect grassland ecosystem, forestry ecosystem, and wetland ecosystem. And all these systems can contribute to the carbon sink. That is why it's very important for us to follow what the red line waving the red line. So at the court, you may ask if you have restrict the region's development, so how about the poor people? So the central government, national government, will provide financial support to the low this is the master picture I would like to share with you. Before I came to US, I traveled to Tibet. And the altitude here is 4,000, more than 4,500. And my colleagues told me like 5 years ago, this region was snow capped. But now we cannot see the snow anymore. Like, even last year, there is no snow. So I just want to say like global warming, climate change is really happening. Maybe I know there are still like arguments about whether it is real happening, whether it is caused by the human behaviors. But like in my personal point of view, yes, we know it's happening. It doesn't matter. It is doesn't matter whether we have figured out the causes, where the causes come from. We just do what we should do. Otherwise, well, if we find, okay, it's the human's fault, that if we want to take actions until that day, it must be too late. So, thanks for your attention.
Basically, the Chinese carbon market, you know, the credit are issued by the central government, and there are two kind of carbon credit. One is based on mandatory cap, and another kind is voluntary reduction. So, because China's carbon market has not yet related to other countries, so I think at this stage it's very difficult for Chinese carbon market to recognize the reductions from overseas to be recognized. I think at this stage, and also China's market has not yet even linked to the management of green supply chain, even, I think. So we have a long way to go. But I think there are spaces. Yeah.
Well, one aspect of that, the difference is between international credit trading between the regulated ETFs and voluntary markets. So I'm wondering if those will progress in different paths or voluntary credits could be traded internationally. If they were all of the same standard, if they all were credited the same way or verified the same way.
I think we need to work jointly to promote this kind of arrangement, I think. Yes, there are spaces. I fully agree with you.
And you had indicated before that a lot of this was being done in conjunction
discussion with APEC.
Yeah.
So that hopefully that also provides opportunities to involve.
Yes, and also the technical support is very important to realize your concept, I think. Because the network, cooperation network of green supply chain endorsed by APEC provides us a potential for future, you know, integration of voluntary credit. And maybe someday, mandatory market, carbon market. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Kevin. I'm from Citizens Climate Lobby. I have several questions for Professor Xu and Professor Wu. First question is, China's 7 pilot regional emission case systems is 2013. What is the future expectations of national emission trade system? And what is the role of regional emission trade system playing in the whole scope in China?
Yes, it's a very good question. This is such a question I would be asked by three people. In China, we know it's a central government city. Maybe when we said the central China government said something, that's just what it did. Generally, it's a little, maybe it's a little complex. And we have the central city. When the central government set the target of to build such a carbon trading city, yes, that means so many factories. Yeah, generally it's factory, maybe companies, and will attend the issue. The central government will set a standard for the carbon emission. And beyond this standard, they should attend in. That's me. And here they will operate for reduction, carbon emission reduction. And in the local government, they want to cooperate, make together the two or more than two environment target aims. And for example, climate, energy, and carbon pollution, they meet it together. That means carbon emission is just one part of the local government's target. They love to do this and reduce the carbon emission and reduce the pollution emission. It's yes, it's an interactive city. Yeah.
I have a question regarding this question. Many scholars say that the carbon allowance in those 7 pilots were actually over-allocated because of grandfathering distribution method. What are your thoughts on this issue, and what ways that the national ETS emission trade system can avoid making the same mistake in the next few years?
Excuse me, can you repeat your question slower and make sure we can understand you very clearly?
Go ahead.
It's okay.
I was not a UP English person, we say in Chinese. Many scholars say that the carbon lines were over allocated almost in every pilot's grandfathering distribution method. What are your thoughts on this issue, and what are the ways that the national emission trade system can avoid making the same mistake?
Okay, that's fine, that's fine. Yeah, actually, 我来回答你了，就他说这个。 欧洲的这个超发了，然后这种可能性，这个事情在中国会不会也有这种可能？怎么样避免这个错误？You know, carbon control in China just started from maybe 10 years ago, and the basis are very big. So, actually, to the best of my understanding, China launched its carbon reduction plans, mostly rely on the carbon market. So there are many issues because, you know, we have no data record. And we are not, you know, because the we don't have this kind of reliable data, historical data, and because of the dramatic development of the economy, so it's very difficult for. I think it's much more difficult than the European to allocate their credits. So I think at some in some degree, there are some kind of these issues, but we do it better than we do nothing. Everybody make mistakes, but you can only improve by make mistakes sometimes. Thank you.
And that way, you will also begin to gather data so that you will establish better baselines
yes.
and be able to move forward.
Yes.
Hi, my name is Mayor of one of our quarterly community news. Thank you very much for this discussion. All of you mentioned international cooperation as the name of the United China's climate activities, but we've had an election here last week in the United States, and the incoming administration has a team view of cooperating with China. And as France will draw from the Paris Climate Accords in particular, how important is U.S. buy-in or U.S. cooperation to China's domestic activities as far as fighting climate change? And how would that affect China's ambitions going forward if the U.S. does not participate as actively as they have in the past?
Yeah, it's very, very big questions. And yeah, because the world changed every day. And now, China government have begun the climate change actions from 20 years before. We do much on this. And before 2005, we just do the climate change in the science level and maybe also in the energy aspect. When the Kyoto Protocol go to power, green power, and we do many, the climate action increase very fast, and we built a new CDM in China. And from, that means 10 years before. And our target is very clear. Climate change is tightly related to many things in China. The core task of the China government, from the central government to local government, development is a very important task. But environment is also very important. Yes, in Mr. Liu's presentation, we have found the pictures, the photos for the pollution air. It's very important for China also. From last year, we released three plan on the soil, air and water, and it's very clear our environmental target. We missed together of the targets of the climate pollution and development and energy, so many. And we found we can do this if we mixed together such targets. Yes, if the political changed, maybe change for the climate policy. I don't think it's the basic will be changed. In 2001, President Bush said U.S. Go out of the Kyoto Protocol. But then, now the, from 2014, and Obama and President Xi, they discussed further on the climate change. We opened the new period of climate change, the world climate change. And the Paris Agreement is, I think, opens the new door for the climate affairs. And we found the new bright tomorrow for the climate change over the world. I think the trend will be not changed, never. Thank you.
May I add something, little comment? Actually, we borrowed the concept of carbon trading from the USA. And we are persuaded, China, in many occasions, China persuaded by the USA and other developing countries to fighting climate change. And now we are facing a very interesting situation. And I think China has sent a very clear signal. China has used greening development as its development principles. So I don't think China will change, even anybody else won't do the thing as they promised. But I think the participation of the U.S. is very important for China because this is the two important economies in the world. If the degree of collaboration reduced, I don't think China will face greater pressure domestically and overseas to carry out its actions. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Ian. I work at the China Environment Forum for Global Citizens, and my question is directed to India still. Citizen science has been growing very strongly in China over the last few years to where now you have non-governmental organizations working with governments at the district and city level for implementing their environmental programs. For example, Green Phenomenon worked with the city of Changsha to develop their 35-year plan. Do you think that the trend of the Chinese government allowing greater impact to come from civil society, from sources that are external to the Chinese government itself, is going to continue, or do you feel that there's only so much in respect to the environment, there's only so much to be done before the government continues to keep on exerting its own effects?
Thanks for your question. I do agree. Actually, as you may all know, in China, the NGOs development, they don't have the same free environment as the American NGOs have. But now, what I feel is the NGOs, they are still like, they are fighting the zigzag way to do what they want to do. And the government is becoming much opener than before. So I think the government, the people, like, because I work for the government, and I think I have global view, and when I become the middle age, so you can see, I mean, like the talented people, so we work for the government and our view will change, so the whole decision makings will get changed as well. So that's what I want to say. As you just mentioned, I think in the coming future the government will much more welcome the NGOs and other organizations. We work together and we contribute to the policy makings.
Griffin Barron from the Dan Downing's office. I have a quick question, just about, I'm not sure if you mentioned it, but the research that will be done concerning the carbon tax, what exactly does that entail? Is that more of a scientific inquiry, or is that more of a research into the application of such a tax?
Good question. To the best of my knowledge, the ministry are highly involved and take lead in this kind of research. It's very serious, not at the technical research stage. Mainly for resolve the issue of middle and small size enterprises, because carbon market more focused on big plants.
Yeah. I mean, I guess the source of my question is to kind of throw back my own thinking. At least in America, it seems as though it's more of a question of whether or not actual science can back the tax itself, and not necessarily the implementation of it. We haven't maybe got as far as you have. I'm not sure where the public stands in China on this issue. I really don't know very much about the sentiment really in China, but I do know just from my own understanding of social media and then my generation of millennials, most people are on consensus to in America. However, I think the general public maybe not as much. What is your sense in terms of the implementation? Is that something that would be more direct in towards like a local government? For example, in Miami, they've already built up roads that were previously flooded in areas along the coastline. Would you see an issue arising within maybe the next half century in terms of flooding for low-lying areas? So if we can agree on that in terms of the projections, what exactly is being done in terms of taxation and then government implementation?
Yeah, thanks for your explanation. I'm not very much involved in that research program.
You say you're from Hong Kong, right?
Yeah. I obtain my...
On a low sea level, would you think Hong Kong is?
We learned a lot last time, this Monday in Boston. They do a lot of research on this, but in China, I'm not come from the research area, so I'm not quite sure. I think, 就是关于海平面什么这个，气候。
Yeah.
Originally, I was from the Ministry of Science and Technology, which is a funding agency for research. And I think before I came here, around 10 years ago, we already started funding research regarding climate change adaptation. We support some research institutions. They can come up with some modeling to model the forecast the future sea rise level parameters, and they were working with local kind of standard making institutions. They come up with standard to form better infrastructure, which including the things you were mentioning, the dikes and roads and etc. And since every government they work like in my departments, a lot of standards which were issued by other ministries, they need to understand what is happening and what is going to happen. And then their decision and the standard they were making need to be based on that. So in sum, the Chinese government already funded research on that regard, and they are working internally in different ministries, and they're working together to have better standards to prepare for the future climate change impact. That takes time, and it also works differently. As you mentioned, in United States, the states, they need to have their funding resources for the infrastructure. And in China, definitely, the provinces, they need to have their own resource. But the central government, they have also their funding channel. They can encourage the local government to pay more attention on a better preparedness for the increasing resilience to climate change. Is that clear to you?
Thank you so much. And it strikes me that in terms of thinking about the national plan, the provincial plan, the local plan, that there are many issues that would come up at the local area that would then need to be recognized by the provincial and by the national plans. And I, during the course of the last year, just in watching the news, I have been struck by some of the some terribly damaging severe weather events that have created huge amounts of flooding and displacement of people as a result of horrific typhoons that have hit various parts of China. And so I think all of those things have an impact in terms of think of local governments thinking about how do we adapt, how do we become more resilient, the same conversations that so many cities here in the U.S. are also having, which is why I think conversations among all of us so that we can figure out how we do a better job with regard to our infrastructure is terribly important and can be very, very powerful. So I want to thank you all very, very much, and thank you. And I hope that if you have additional questions, please do ask them, let us know. And I want to thank our wonderful panel very, very much for your being here, for sharing your concerns, your expertise. And now we look forward to hearing about all of the things that you're going to accomplish. So thank you.